The shadow has no power over us, for we will trust in the Lord. And through the night we have a song to sing, a hope that we can cling to. Joy will come in the morning, joy will come in the morning. God is our rock and our salvation. Joy will come.
Yeah, I can't, at the end of it, when he says, "Tell, you know, am I a good man?" Every time I fall to pieces.
The end of Schindler's List.
Oof.
He looks at his watch and he thinks about the lives that that watch could have saved.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's the part that.
Yeah, that's the part that you just. Yeah.
You hear it out. It just is undoing.
It's really, yeah, it's very powerful.
This week, talking about suffering. Talking about unimaginable suffering.
Yeah.
I guess we're all kind of depending on Rob this week to make sense of Job for us.
Sure, that's it.
I mean, I've been waiting for this, you know, since September when we began the With God Life series, and I was like, I can't wait till we get to Job. And I didn't know you were preaching. I just thought whoever's preaching, and I hope it's not me, we're finally going to find out, you know, all of the answers that have eluded us.
Well, we got that inspired, didn't we? We know that it's not the answers that God sent, but they weren't giving us simplistic answers.
And you know, that theodicy, this idea of God, a God who is God in the midst of this suffering? What is God's role in our lives as we suffer? We always want to make meaning of it, right? You know, hey, this refines you. You know, we talk about the pressure it takes to make a diamond. this is going to make me beautiful, and this is going to make me valuable. And oftentimes, it reduces us and increases God. So God's the hero of the story. So this week, while we prepare for worship at White Plains, as you join us, I would love for you to go to the place where you keep your bread and go to the place where you keep your juice and go ahead and gather your elements for communion. We'll be sharing Holy Communion together and with you, the congregation, later on in this worship service. Today, we have baklava croissant that Jay had me warm up to perfection, sharing it with my good friend Bert. Lee and Rob don't get any. I think actually they ate the other one. But, you know, the carbs and powdered sugar notwithstanding, we're sharing a meal together today. We're at a table talking about one of the most difficult narratives in all of Scripture, and maybe something that Pastor Rob will not resolve for us in his sermon. And I would encourage you to be okay with that. Look for God in the story. Look for God in the relationship he has with his creation, Job. And look for God in the relationship he has with Job's detractors, Job's supporters, Job's critics, and Job's very succinct wife. the best sentence maybe in all of the wisdom literature in the Bible. I'm Jason Darden. I am the youth pastor here at White Plains. I'm joined with worship leader, choir director, Bert Fox. Bert has some amazing music planned for us in worship this Sunday, and we're going to include some amazing worship music with this online worship service. So I'm Jason Darden. On behalf of my favorite White Plains staff of all time, welcome to White Plains. Thank you.
In her book, Inspired, Rachel Held Evans imagines the story of Job as a conversation happening between divinity school professors. Job has been through it. You see that guy over there in the middle? That's Job. He's had some horrible stuff going on. And the people with him are his friends, Eli, and Bill, and Dr. Z. And they're going to try and just be with him and maybe even cheer him up a little bit.
Hey, man, we got this for you. It's not much, I know, but under the circumstances, we wanted to do something.
God will never give you more than you can handle.
What? What's the problem?
It's a tad cliche, don't you think? God never gives you more than you can handle. What's that even mean?
It's a card, Bill. It's not a theological statement.
Everything's a theological statement. You, of all people, should know that.
Look, this obviously happened for a reason. We know God is in control and there's some divine purpose at work here. We don't need to spell it out for Job. He gets it. I figure just a few words of comfort would encourage him to consider what he might learn from this time of discipline. Blessed is the one whom God corrects. So do not despise the discipline of the Almighty. For he wounds, but he also binds up. He injures, but his hands also heal.
Well, that would have been a much better way to say it. Really, this should serve as a reminder that we're all just one sin away from similar judgment. If anything, we ought to be urging Job to repent so God will show mercy. You know, if you seek God earnestly and plead with the Almighty, if you are pure and upright, even now he will rouse himself on your behalf.
Of what should Job repent? What specific sins?
Aren't all sins specific, Eli?
Well, sure, but I guess I'm asking if you think Job did something definitive to bring this on, or if it's more like a result of God's wrath on his general sinful state. You said it could happen to any of us.
Yeah, but it didn't happen to any of us. It happened to Job.
Right, I know, but why?
Pride, greed, sloth.
I'm not seeing Job exhibit any of these qualities.
It must be an addiction.
Addiction? Oh, good grief, Bill. It always comes back to addiction with you. You really think God's so enraged, he sends a rainstorm, a drunk driver to the very road where... Oh, God, sorry. Sorry, dude. So sorry.
God rewards the righteous and punishes evildoers. The Bible is clear on that. Does God pervert justice? Does the Almighty pervert what is right? Certainly not. Whatever the sin, it was severe enough to warrant correction. We have to trust that God is just.
Well, I agree, Bill, but it doesn't have to be that direct cause and effect. I think it's entirely possible this is a result of God's general anger toward sin, like with the earthquake a few weeks ago or the famine in Sudan, not necessarily a direct effect of Job's addiction.
Job has an addiction?
According to Bill, everyone has an addiction.
Yep.
All I'm saying is, I think it's entirely possible God did this to discipline Job's sins in general, not one sin in particular, which should sober us all. Hardship does not spring from the soil, nor does trouble sprout from the ground. Yet man is born to trouble as surely as sparks fly upward.
I don't think Job's convinced that he's guilty of anything. Do you think you are blameless, Job?
I don't know.
Do you recognize, man, this is an opportunity for repentance?
No, not really.
Well, I'm sorry to hear that.
I just don't think I've done anything wrong, Doctor.
Oh, how I wish that God would speak, that he would open his lips against you and disclose to you the secrets of wisdom. He's already overlooked so much of your sin, Job. How can you claim to be blameless if God confines you to prison and convenes a court? Who can oppose him? You must repent, brother, and turn your heart to him. Put away your sins, and God will work this out for good.
I think we should consider that maybe this isn't just about Job's sin, but the sins of the ones actually in the accident.
All right, enough. Enough. Y'all are lying about me, you fools, so stop it. You think because you got a bunch of fancy theology degrees that you can divine what I happen to be up to? Tell me, who keeps the earth spinning in its orbits? You? Who knows every dimension of the cosmos, huh? Who formed galaxies out of dark matter and brought forth life out of the sea? Any of you? Who knows every strand of DNA in every single plant and every animal and every person in the world? And who's acquainted with every human sorrow, from the tears of a child to the groans of a slave? Who can fathom the depths of the ocean? You got that? Who can start or stop the rain? Who knows intimately the contents of every human heart? Any of you? That's right. Not one of you. So y'all lay off my servant Job. He's not done a single thing wrong. He's blameless. He's upright. He is a man of kindness and integrity, which is more than I can say for the three of you. So, Job, why don't you come with me? I know you got a lot of things to get off your chest.
Welcome to one of our classrooms here at White Plains. If you're watching us online, perhaps you may never even have seen one of these. Or if you've been away for a while, maybe you haven't seen some of the renovations and things that have gone on here. But every Sunday morning, people gather in rooms like this. This class is learning all about our With God Life series and following along with us. Some classrooms sit around tables and discuss, or in circle, or perhaps in a room like this, we're teaching from the front, and you have a teacher up front who's giving the lesson. Many of our Sunday school classes have a Zoom option where they use the screen behind me here to bring in people who are traveling or even perhaps at home or who live in a different area. So if you are watching this and live in a different area, that might be an option for you. Get in touch with us. We'd love to talk with you about connecting to a small group here. Well, if you do join a small group and you find yourself teaching in a setting like this, you need to communicate a lesson, an insight into the nature and presence of God. Let me give you a tip. There are four words you can use that are guaranteed to draw your listener in and make them more engaged with whatever it is you have to say. Now, it's not "my name is Rob Phillips," although my name is Rob Phillips. The four words are these: once upon a time. Once upon a time. Even if you're charged with communicating the driest of content, beginning with a story works. We're wired for stories. Whether it's binge watching a serial drama on TV or reading the latest from your favorite author or Wednesdays at the comic shop, there's something about a good story that draws us in and captures our attention like nothing else. God knows this. God made us to be wired for stories. Jesus' favorite way of teaching was telling stories and asking questions. If you've ever read any of Jesus' stories or parables, you know they aren't there for historical knowledge, but rather to give insight into the kingdom of God, the way things are in heaven, the way that we pray they will be one day on earth, every time we join together in the Lord's Prayer. And that's what the book of Job does. It gives us a story. It tells us a lot about God, and yet leaves us with a lot of questions. It's classified as wisdom literature. And at times, it's more poetic than narrative. It's a long book, 42 chapters, but with a relatively small cast of characters, some of whom you've already met in our little drama that you saw earlier. There's Job, of course, our central character. He's a wealthy and prosperous man who's described from the very beginning as righteous and a devoted follower of God. And then there's God, who really only speaks at the beginning and the end of the book, but whose character and nature are the real subject of the story. Then there's Job's three friends, Eliphaz, Bildad, and Zophar. You've heard some of their words already, taken straight from the text. There's a few more characters. There's Job's wife, who initially sympathizes with his suffering, but tells him at one point to just curse God or die. And then there's Elihu, a young man who comes in near the end of the story. He's apparently been listening to all this back and forth between Job and his friends, and he can't help but offer his opinions. And then appearing only in the prologue at the beginning of the story, there's a very troubling character. You probably read it as Satan, but the devil. But it's best understood in this context as the Satan, which translates as accuser or adversary, a member of the heavenly court who seems to want to cause trouble and has some questions about why Job is faithful. The prologue of Job's story reads more like mythology than history. It consists of God boasting of Job as a faithful follower to the rest of the heavenly court, and enter the adversary, who argues that Job only follows God because God has blessed him, and that if his prosperity was taken away, he would curse God. To which God replies, "Go for it. Do your worst to him and see what happens." Now, I don't know about you, but I don't find that a particularly comforting image of God, because it turns out that the Satan's worse is pretty bad. In a single day, Job loses his possessions, his children, standing in the community. He's even afflicted with sores to the point where he is scraping his skin with pottery shards just to get some kind of relief. What's important to understand about this prologue is that it does not reveal the true character of God, because we will see more of that later. The point of the prologue is to let us know, the hearer of this story, that Job is blameless. He's suffering, and he did nothing to bring this suffering on himself. And that's a fact that no one around him seems to be able to reconcile. This is the heart of the book of Job, and why it's so important for us as we go through this with God life journey. Because we've seen the people of God grow from individuals to a family to tribes to a nation. But if they are to grow to be the all-inclusive, all-caring, all-loving, Christ-centered community that we see in the second chapter of Acts, then they're going to have to learn to deal with the question of suffering. And Job is a wisdom book. It's written in a language of speeches and monologues, more Shakespearean sonnet than sequential narrative. And it turns conventional wisdom, even scriptural wisdom, on its head. You reap what you sow. Sin leads to suffering. Righteousness leads to prosperity. That's what we're taught, aren't we? And if we had time, we could go chapter and verse on it. Perhaps some of you may have had an encounter with someone like Job's friends. And yet at the beginning and the end of the story, God assures us that Job has done nothing wrong to deserve this suffering. And what suffering it is. You know, I read this section from Job chapter 3 in the Witness podcast that Jason and I did discussing the book of Job. It's on the With God Life page of our website if you'd like to listen to that discussion. But I can't get it out of my head. Job 3 says, "Why is light given to those in misery and life to the bitter of soul? To those who long for death that does not come, who search for it more than hidden treasure, who are filled with gladness and rejoice when they reach the grave? Why is life given to a man whose way is hidden, whom God has hedged in? For sighing has become my daily food. My groans pour out like water. What I feared has come upon me. What I dreaded has happened to me. I have no peace, no quietness. I have no rest, only turmoil." It reads like William Butler Yeats, right? Scriptures like this give me comfort that when I feel at my worst, there is a language in Scripture that can describe my despair. And back and forth it goes. The bulk of the book is taken up with speeches from Job's friends, one after another. And finally, the young Elihu, all extolling the virtue and the righteousness of God and how such a just and powerful being would not allow suffering without cause. Something, again, that the prologue makes clear that's exactly what's happening. Interspersed between those speeches are Job's responses. His anger that he's falsely accused, his despair at his suffering, his grief for what he has lost. And in his grief and anger, he questions God, but he never loses faith. In chapter 19, Job relates how his appearance and sickness has made him repulsive to everyone, even his wife and family. And yet, in Job 19:25, he says, "I know my Redeemer lives, and at the last he will stand upon the earth." Job's friends agree with this, of course. They believe in the righteousness and the power and majesty of God. But they're also sure that there must be some hidden sin, something that Job must repent from, something that is separating him from God, that he professes to worship. Because that's what the Bible says. And then finally, after what must have seemed like an eternity to Job, God shows up. Chapter 38 says that God speaks out of a whirlwind, and God reminds everyone, especially us, the hearers of this story, just who we are and who God is. God asks, "Where were you when I laid the foundations of the earth? Have you entered into the springs of the sea or walked its depths? Have you entered the storehouses of the snow? Who has cut a channel for the torrents of rain or made way for the thunderbolt?" God asks Job about the stars. God says, "Can you bind the cords of the Pleiades or loosen the belt of Orion?" And God covers the entire animal kingdom, from ostrich feathers to mountain goats giving birth to the soaring wings of the hawk. Who made all that? Who made you, Job? God speaks. And all Job can do in response is to be silent. Scripture says he places his hand over his mouth, saying, "I have spoken, but I will speak no more." And when Job finally does speak, he's humbled, and he repents from his questioning and his anger. And then, still speaking out of the whirlwind, God turns upon the friends and lets them know just how wrong they are and how wrong they were to accuse Job. Job did nothing wrong. And God says that now it is Job who will pray for them and their salvation. God hears Job's prayers and restores the friends as well. Finally, God restores to Job all that was lost, and the story ends on an upbeat note. And one fascinating detail in this ending is how the storyteller details Job's restoration. He lists out the material wealth that is returned to him, and that makes perfect sense in Job's ancient culture. 14,000 sheep, 6,000 camels. But the story goes on to say that his family is renewed as well. He has 7 sons and, very significantly, 3 daughters who are named in the story, where the sons are not. That's unusual enough. But the storyteller makes a point to say that the daughters are given an equal inheritance to their brothers. Job's daughters were given an equal share of inheritance to their brothers. Now, our modern ears can't understand just how radical this is in this culture. This is extremely countercultural and very radical, given this patriarchal and materialism-based society. And there's no explanation for this given in the text. But it runs counter to culture and to Scripture. As God instructs Moses in Numbers 27 that daughters can only receive an inheritance if there are no surviving sons. That's not the case here. I've got no explanation for this except to say that Job has had an encounter with an all-loving and all-powerful God. He's experienced God's mercy. And when that happens, you're changed. Job has changed. And Job is now making decisions based on a better knowledge of the true character of God. Maybe he views life a little differently after that. So what do we make of all this? Well, one takeaway that Rachel Hedda Evans suggests in her book, Inspired, is that perhaps wisdom is best heard from those who have actually suffered rather than those who have only read about it. So we should probably lean into the example of Job's friends when they first encounter Job. Because when they hear of his suffering, they come and they sit with him for 7 days in silent solidarity. And they only really begin to get in trouble when they open their mouths to speak. Perhaps when we're tempted to quote a scripture to someone, we should pray long and hard. Lord, what would you have me say? Lord, what would you have me do? Because it turns out that people in travail are especially loved by God and favored by God. Those that Jesus calls the least of these in Matthew 25. He says that is where he will be found. And it turns out that Job's friends were wrong because they relied on what they had read and learned and not being aware of Job's situation. Just like we will later hear Jesus clarify in the Sermon on the Mount, the law isn't wrong. It's just not simple. And looking to the Bible for the answers to life's questions isn't a bad thing. It's just not an easy thing. The Bible doesn't give an answer. It gives answers. It doesn't speak with one voice, but many. And sometimes God speaks in the whirlwind. And sometimes God speaks in the silence. What we are called to do, the spiritual discipline that permeates every word of this book, is to endure, to cling to faith as if it were the last bit of wreckage from our sinking ship, and hope it will carry us to new shores, like Paul washing up on the beach of Malta in Acts 27. Grief and suffering is real. If you're in it, you know it. I think we're all going through grief and suffering from our time during the pandemic. You don't just go through a time period like that as individuals or as a congregation or community. And you don't suffer loss like that and just bounce back to the way things were. Sometimes suffering happens, and it doesn't mean that God is absent or has forgotten God's promises. Far from it. Job's faithfulness and endurance is rewarded by a God that is bigger than any adversary, bigger than any earthly tribulation, bigger than any well-intentioned but ultimately harmful, shallow reading of the Scriptures. As Luther wrote, God's truth abideth still. And as John Wesley said, best of all, God is with us. Thanks be to God.
Christ our Lord invites to his table all who love him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, in the humility of realizing that, let's confess our sin before God and one another. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbor, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were yet sinners. That proves God's love toward us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven.
Glory to God. Amen.
Saving God, you are the giver of life, the source of deepest compassion, the fountain of eternal life. And so we pray to you today for all who are thirsty. Thirsty for a life of meaning, thirsty for a word of grace, thirsty for a drink of water. We pray for all who are weary, weary from life's long journey, weary from quarreling and testing, weary from pain or grief.
We pray for all who are broken, broken by sin and suffering, broken by shame and rejection, broken by acts of violence. And we remember that in Jesus, too, you were broken. And we remember that he took bread as he gathered around a table with his friends and gave thanks to you, broke that very bread and gave it to his friends and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And when that supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Living God, by your Spirit, pour your love into our hearts today, your grace into our lives, your healing into our world, and make this bread and this juice be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ, redeemed by his blood. That until the earth is filled with all your glory, we will continue to praise your name and sing with your angels. Amen. And as Jesus taught us, we pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. This bread which we break together is a sharing in the body of Christ. And this cup over which we give thanks together is a sharing in the blood of Christ. We invite you at home to partake of your communion sets or whatever you have, and let us feast on God's grace together. Every creature's unique in the song that it sings, all exclaiming, indescribable. Eternal God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given your very self to us. Grant that we may go into the world in the strength of your Spirit to give ourselves for others. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Bert, I was sick last week.
I know, I heard. You're feeling better?
I am feeling better.
Good.
I had not had an opportunity to watch worship online. Let me put it this way. I was not forced to watch worship online in a very long time. And I felt oddly comforted watching last week's worship service. And I'm grateful that we're still able to do this.
Yeah. And I was away because I was in Louisville at a conference. And so also I was able to maintain worship by watching it online.
Yeah,
so it was good to be able to still be a part of the church family, albeit remotely. Yeah,
I miss people. Mm-hmm. I mean, for me, church is people, very much the relationships that we have with people here. But I did not feel disconnected at all. Sunday school class fed us. Kelly Lynn sent us a Grubhub card, and so we were being cared for. Never felt but the worship life continued to feel connected as well. So, you know, people were helping and serving us, and we also felt connected through worship. You know, I listening to Rob preach the sermon, you know, I've got more questions than we got answers. Mm-hmm. But the dynamics of our relationship with each other and with God, I'm grateful that we're in the middle of continuing to film, mm-hmm. To find new ways to worship in person, to be able to help people continue to feel connected, living a life with each other, and living a life following Christ. And thanks for all that you do as part of that.
You're welcome.
Yeah, you're welcome. Yeah, I mean, that's the correct answer. Also, can I have the rest of that?
Absolutely.
Okay, great. So I'm going to eat the rest of this. You are going to go into the world and make disciples, not using the lessons from Job, maybe. Maybe we focus more on gospel stuff when we do that, but definitely remembering that in the midst of suffering, God is with us. God is always with us. I'm Jason Darden. I'm the youth pastor at White Plains, and I am very glad to be able to tell you that we enjoyed worshiping with you today. Thanks for worshiping at White Plains. We will rise up. We will rise up. In the morning, we're gonna rise up. We will rise up. In the morning, we're gonna rise up. Mm-hmm. We will rise up. And I